On Hot Copy this morning, Senate President Juan Miguel Zubiri also seeks a 150 peso daily wage increase for workers in the private sector. Zubiri filed the measure Tuesday, citing the effects of high inflation. His move comes days after the Macabayan Bloc at the House of Representatives filed a bill calling for a 750 peso across the board daily wage increase. All right, joining us now this morning on Hot Copy, it's a privilege to have with us on the program, we have Senate President Juan Miguel Zubiri. All right, let's check. Senate President, are you okay there? How's your signal?
Hi, Karen, can you hear me?
I can hear you. You're not yet on air. Let's try again. Senate President, there.
Yes. Hi, Karen. Good morning to everyone. Good morning to you, my dear.
All right. Very good. Okay. So before we talk about the bill that you had filed, I think the bigger story, it seems, is really coming from the lower house. Let's talk about that. Congressman Rufus Rodriguez says the Senate cannot ignore the overwhelming support for charter change. And out of interchamber courtesy, he's calling on the Senate to tackle any measure passed by the House, especially if it's been approved by an overwhelming vote, and he says requires urgent attention.
Sometimes I get confused. No, I don't know what requires urgent attention. The priority measures of the DAC, Legislative Executive Development, the cooperation, our group made of the House of Representatives, Senate, and the executive, which discusses the priority measures needed for our country. And charter change is not there. You don't know that the president already said that it is not part of his agenda. It is not a priority of the president. And to answer the fears of my dear colleagues, I don't want to pick a fight. You know, Karen, I, as interparliamentary courtesy, I'll never pick a fight with the members of the House of Representatives. I came from the House of Representatives for 9 years, so I have my utmost respect for them. But we are tackling charter change through Senator Robin Hood Padilla. He's going around the country doing his hearings and public hearings and listening tour. As a matter of fact, I never stopped him. Last I discussed with him yesterday, continue your job. He's the chairman of the Committee on Constitutional Amendments, so he's doing his job. We have not prevailed upon him to stop that. So he's doing his job. We are doing our job to listen to the people's voice on this particular issue. Going to the gist of it, Karen, I don't understand why our dear colleagues in the House would like to rush this when, in all honesty, we passed the economic measures in the 18th Congress as majority floor leader. And of course, Speaker Martin was majority floor leader when we passed the Public Services Act of Grace Poe. We passed the Retail Trade Act of Senator Coco Pimentel. And we passed the Foreign Investments Act, of which Senator Aimee Marcos was the sponsor and author together with all of us. These three was to answer the problem of the economic provisions in restrictive economic provisions in the Constitution. Now, what was the PSA? The PSA now allows foreign ownership of utilities, telcos, TV stations, even highways, subways, railway stations, airports. It allows it now. That was the most restrictive part of the Constitution when it came to economic provisions. Now, the argument of my dear friend, and I have the highest respects for him, he's my neighbor in Cagayan de Oro, Congressman Rufus Rodriguez, is that there's a case in the Supreme Court. Yes, we knew that somebody would file a case against the Public Services Act in the Supreme Court. However, the Supreme Court, Karen, never released a TRO. Yeah. And therefore, the law stays until the decision is made. So why don't we wait for the decision of the Supreme Court? The Supreme Court may say that it's constitutional. Remember that in the Senate, it was no other than Senator Frank Drilon, who was former DOJ secretary, our resident constitutionalist, who co-sponsored this with Senator Grace Poe, who defended the provisions that it is not unconstitutional. And so we are confident that it is constitutional and stand the test of the Supreme Court scrutiny. Now, moving forward. So our position is, why don't we wait for the decision of the Supreme Court? If it says it's constitutional, why do we have to amend the Constitution? Now, there's also another issue. It's not being implemented. Why? The implementing rules and regulations, Karen, after 1 year, have not been released. Hindi pa linalabas yung implementing rules and regulations, IRR, nitong batas. Hindi ko po alam bakit. Are they delaying it for some underlying reason? Why don't they already let IRR go and let it out so that more foreign direct investments can come to the country? Obviously, they're still in a quandary what the implementing rules and regulations are. So let us release the Public Services Act implementing rules and regulations together with the Retail Trade and Foreign Investments Act.
If you
ask me, Karen, to close my argument, what else do we want need to loosen up in the Constitution for economic provisions? Is it the ownership of land? Because I personally am against the ownership of land. Why? People tell me, hindi naman nila madala yung lupa eh, sa kanilang bansa. Pero totoo niyan, Karen, kung bubuksan natin yung ownership of land, mamahal at mamahal ang lupa dito sa ating bansa. Katulad na nangyari sa Canada, many countries, even Europe now, Spain,
New Zealand,
many of their countrymen are complaining that they cannot anymore buy their own homes in their own countries. Alam mo, staff ko lang, Karen, dahil nga sa napakaraming Chinese dito na nationals from mainland China na namimili ng condominium at nag-rent ng bahay. Mga staff ko sa Senado, hirap na maghanap na ng studio apartment or one-bedroom apartment doon sa Mall of Asia area near the Senate. Because everything, a studio, what used to be 20,000 a month, 20,000 pesos, is now up to 50,000 a month dahil nga it's being rented out by foreign nationals from China. So my people, our own Filipino people, can't even rent within their own cities. Nandun pa sila sa Cavite para mag-rent ng tahanan para makapasok po sila sa Senado. So punto ko, that's the only provision left. And I'm sure that it's going to be very difficult if we open it up because we all know who's going to come here and buy all the homes in all the high-end subdivisions, including all the other homes all around Metro Manila. It's going to be our neighbor, right? And not exactly a strategic move to make.
Okay, Senate President, let's go back first a little. You revealed something today that was quite surprising, that there's still no IRR when it comes to the amendments in the Public Service Act and retail trade liberalization. My question is, who's supposed to make that?
Well, the departments concerned is supposed to make that. NEDA is supposed to release that. We discussed it in the LEDAC, and they're saying there's still agencies that are delayed in giving their comments. Oh, come on. It's been a year, Karen. They should bring out the implementing rules and regulations already yesterday. They should have brought it out yesterday. Not today, not tomorrow, but yesterday. So, and then they're blaming us that it's not working, na wala pumapasok ng foreign direct investment. Wala na po yan sa legislatura. Tapos na kami. Ang trabaho namin, we're done. It was been pending with us for about 30 years, and we were finally able to amend it in the 18th Congress. So the ball now is in the executive's court, Karen, to bring out the IRR and finally implement the Public Services Act so that it will address the concerns of the congressman when it comes to foreign direct investment. And okay, to be honest, Karen, you took up a very important point earlier. You honestly think in a CONCON that they will only discuss an economic solution? Hindi lang po lamang ang economic provisions ng Constitution ang pag-uusapan dyan. With due respect to my colleagues, with due respect to Congressman Rufus Rodriguez, who's a very, he's a very well-known lawyer and a very good lawyer at that. Once the CONCON is set up, they will not be limited to just economic provisions. Pwede nilang repasuhin ang Article 1 to the last article of the Constitution, baguhin lahat yan, pati economic provisions. E paano naman yan, Karen? Huwag may economic provisions na tanggalin nila yung term limits, tanggalin nila yung, or i-extend pa nila yung terms ng mga politiko aba, ako politiko ako, masaya ako niyan, pero ang taong bayan magagalit sa atin. Magagalit sa atin ang taong bayan. They will really get upset. And what if they change the structure of government? If they change the structure of government, Karen, it's not like passing a simple law. That takes time. That takes time to study. That takes money, funding, especially kung gagawin natin federal form. I used to be a federalist, believer of the federalist form of government. Until I saw the numbers, Karen, nakita ko yung numero. Yung mga regional setups, they wanted to set up several regions for the federal system, federal states. Only 3 federal states would survive in a federal system. That is Metro Manila, Southern Tagalog, and Central Luzon. Everywhere else would collapse immediately after 2 to 3 years. Kasi wala tayong pambayad sa teachers, wala tayong pambayad sa police, wala tayong pambayad sa ating government employees. Magko-collapse yan. Then internally, kulang ang aming pondo, ang ating income, to be able to run the federal states. So it takes a lot of study, a lot of in-depth, consultations, so to be able to get the proper picture. Now, ang punto ko dyan, are we ready for all that change? Mm-hmm. Are we ready for all that change? At this point in time, nakakalabas lang natin ng pandemya, Karen. I'm being bashed. Mm-hmm. Imagine, trabahador nyo sa Senado, I'm being bashed for the lack of output. So, you know, just yesterday, we passed on second reading, 5 important measures in the Senate. We're moving as quickly as we can because it's not quantity, Karen, it's quality. So what is important is let us address post-pandemic issues, which is economic recovery, bringing down inflation, and making our lives of our people a lot easier, a lot simpler, and of course, making them a lot happier.
Okay, so as Senate President, we're going to move to what was recently passed in the Senate, but let's focus on this. You brought up one concern already, which is if you agree to the CONCON, if the Senate agrees, it will be unstoppable. Anything can be touched. It's a whole overhaul. And do you think that your colleagues will support that?
Isa pa yun, Karen, sinabi ko nga in an interview, lagay mo na, I support it. But you know, we have 23 other republics. It's 24 republics in the Senate. Even if I would say no, and at this point in time, I don't support it, but if let's say I support it, I'm only one out of 24 members of the Senate. Mm-hmm. To be honest, Karen, tama yung sinabi ni Senator JV Ayacito kahapon na 4-5 lang ang nabibilang namin na pumapabor sa charter change. And you know, the vote for charter change, Karen, I'd like to correct the misconception yesterday in the news mentioned that it was 2/3 vote. It's not 2/3 vote, Karen. It's 3/4 vote. It's stricter. The amount of members of the House and Senate and the House of Representatives and in the Senate voting separately is 3. As far as I'm concerned, it's voting separately.
It's
3/4 vote, Karen. So 3/4 in the Senate is 18. We need 18 votes to dance the cha-cha.
Yeah.
So I don't think we have 18 votes to dance the cha-cha. Hindi kami makasayaw ng cha-cha. Wala kaming numero para malaman ng taong bayan. 18 boto kailangan ng ating mga kasamahan sa Senado para umunsad ang charter change. Okay. Wala po kaming numero na ganyan. So for us, it's moot and academic. We might as well focus on the DAC priority measures which will help solve the problem of inflation, smuggling, which will increase, lower the inflationary prices, and hopefully, maybe, possibly, better the lives of the Filipino people, maybe through a wage increase, as I'm proposing.
Okay. All right. Before we get there, I'll go back to what you said. So let's go to the argument of Congressman Rufus Rodriguez and those who support it. They say that the Philippine Constitution is the most restrictive in ASEAN. It's the 3rd most restrictive in the world. I mean, those are facts. Just to get on to a more balanced argument, their argument. And there are other questions with the economic provisions. For example, Thailand has a long-term lease of 99 years. $1,000 for foreigners. When it comes to education, the Constitution is quite restrictive. We can't actually partner with a Harvard, a Stanford, all these universities, and they're opening up in other parts of the world. And even natural resources is an argument for these lawmakers. You have arguments of Vietnam getting all the foreign direct investments coming from China. So are you open? Are you entirely against charter change? Karen, or is the manner of Con Con that you disagree with?
No, it's the timing, Karen. The issue of timing. And they always say, timing, but we've been discussing this for 30 years. Yes, but we've been having problems for the last 30 years that we need to address first, which is poverty eradication, educating our people. Now, their argument on the restrictive foreign provisions in the Constitution was addressed already with the PSA. They know that. We passed it together under the Duterte administration. The restrictive portion of the Constitution is the 60-40 rule. The 60, that no foreigner can own 60% majority of, for example, a telco. Now we took that out completely. 100% they can own under the PSA law. The other 60-40 for railways, for subways. So nobody will invest here in big ticket items because 40% yung investor, sino papasok dito? Gusto nila ng majority. We took that out completely.
Can be
totally foreign-owned companies already. Yung retail trade, dati 2.5, malaki, 2.5 million, batas. Yung investment, $2.5 million. Ang para maglagay lang ng store dito, per store yan. Binabangan na namin ng $500,000, which is basically a Jollibee. There was a survey conducted recently, I think it was last year, Karen, on why foreign direct investments have been bypassing the Philippines. So they've interviewed the foreign chambers. Magandang pakinggan ito, Karen. Ha? Wala silang napakalit, very insignificant, single digits on the issue of constitutional prohibitions. Very small.
Yeah.
You know what was number one problem? Ease of doing business. My other law, ease of doing business. It's not being implemented. It's a beautiful law though. It's perfect. But unfortunately, is it being implemented on the local level? No. Inaharas pa rin sila ng mga LGUs na instead of 3 days or maximum of 7 days, 7 working days yung kanilang permits, umabot ng buwan-buwan pa rin. Yung corruption sa malalaking agencies. So it's ease of doing business. Corruption with the big agencies. We've solved that already with ease of doing business. But yet, there are still departments who are releasing their permits, certificates, and licenses that takes 5 to 6 months. We have the law already. Every time I meet with a businessman, yan pong complaint nila sa akin. I sabi ko, walang hiya, may batas na tayo. What are they doing? What's the government doing about it?
So the problem really is the investment climate in the Philippines.
It's the investment climate, peace and order. I was about to reach my third point. One of their complaints was peace and order. Eh, yung nangyari kay Degamo, does that inspire people to invest in the Philippines? That does not inspire a friendly investment climate. And of course, our lack of marketing. To be honest, kaya naingit ako when I opened the CNN and BBC, napapanood ko yung commercials ng Cambodia, napapanood ko yung commercials ng Brazil, invest in Brazil, invest in Cambodia, in Thailand. We don't have any advertising. We have no marketing whatsoever. Ang bukang bibig na lang ang ating Pangulo. In fairness to the President, he's the one that goes around selling the country, but then even he was bashed for traveling so much. But we have fruits. These fruits of his labor are coming back. Next week, we're doing a formal signing. I was able to help bring in the largest e-vehicle manufacturing from the United States. They're called EVT. You can look it up. EVT. Okay. Yeah. They're the biggest public utility. They make public service vehicles in the U.S. na electric. Electric bus, school buses, electric trucks for the different states in the United States. I was able to get them to come to Clark. They're doing a formal signing next week. They're going to hire 2,000 jobs within the this next quarter, and they're going to hopefully be able to open up a larger portion in Clark of their manufacturing and hopefully employ about 5,000 more.
Okay.
So, we don't need amendments to the Constitution on that, but they were able to do it because I handheld the whole process. Sinama ko sila para mag-meetings kay Secretary Pascual. Sinamahan ko sila pag-meetings sa BOI, Board of Investments. And then, and sinamahan ko sila together with my team to Clark para makita nila to lahat. But does it have to be the Senate President who does that to every investor? There should be an investment house in the Philippines. For example, the BOI should step up and do all these things as a one-stop shop. Ika nga, that's what they're saying. Ease of doing business. Vietnam has that. Thailand has that. Singapore has that. They've got investment offices. Just one, not five, just one that takes care of all of them, handholds these investors to come out and locate in the Philippines. Yan ang kailangan natin.
Okay. I'm letting you speak because you're really passionate about this. And UP Professor Edna Ko is listening and watching. And she says, you have great arguments that you're raising on public administration's concern left unminded prior to a call for charter change. So I think you need to be heard on your points when it comes to charter change. Before we move on to the bill you filed, the last question I'll ask you is this. Senator Robin Padilla said that he was against the CONCON. He's concerned. But he said, what if it's a constituent assembly so that there are boundaries to the change if it's really just the economic provisions? That's one. And number two, with the way you sound, Senate President, and also when I interviewed Senator Loren Legarda, Senator J.V. Ejercito, a few of your colleagues, is it fair to say charter change in the Senate is dead?
At this point in time, with the numbers that I'm looking at, we can't get 3/4 vote. At this point in time in the Senate, it's very difficult to discuss or to deviate our legislative track into focus on the constitutional amendments. That's another thing. I had a discussion last night with Senator Robin Hood Padilla. Eh, talagang ayaw niya na ng CONCON. He's the head of the committee, right? So ayaw niya ng CONCON. If there's disagreeing provisions in the House and the Senate, obviously there will be a stalemate on this particular issue. And even then, Karen, we're also worried that there's a gray area in the Constitution. The gray area in the Constitution is on how to vote on these amendments. The framers of the Constitution forgot to make it specific and clear. You know, there are arguments from one side, particularly from our colleagues in the House, that say that they don't say it openly, but they say it privately, that it should be voting as one. Kung voting as one, Karen, yung 24 senador ay talagang lampaso sa 301 members of Congress. So they will be able to reach 3/4 vote without any say from the senators, even if we all vote against. Imagine if the provisions, there will be political amendments, tanggalin yung Senado. My goodness, Karen, this Senate is an institution.
Tinanong ko yun, Senate President, kay Congressman Rodriguez. I said, so if it's limitless, you mean that they can actually remove the senators? And he said, well,
possible.
It's possible.
It's possible.
So sagot nga ng ilan is the Senate shouldn't be selfish just to think of their own. But really, when you think about it, I mean, where can that go? Where can that go?
Alam nyo, Karen, the Senate has been...
tandem,
yes.
Changing term limits. In fact, it's called the hybrid CONCON.
You know, Karen, with due respect to my colleagues in the House of Representatives, sa mga kababayan na nag-iisip na hindi po nila kailangan ng Senado, many times throughout history, ang Senado ang tinatawag po natin last bastion of democracy. Many times when a very powerful person would insist on legislation that is detrimental to national interest, who steps in? It's the senators. We step in because we're elected at large. Hindi po, ano po kami, elected at large, wala po kaming distrito pinoprotektahan. Kasi kung distrito lang pinoprotektahan namin, medyo hindi po kami masyado maingay dahil siyempre natatakot din kami na mawawala kami ng projects o pondo para sa ating mga distrito kami. Iba po, we're supposed to be above the fray, the political fray in the local level. Para makadesisyon po tayo para sa ating mga kababayan na karapat dapat no, na ibigay sa kanila. You know, it's been an institution since 1916. So sobrang 100 years na po ang Senado. And you have the likes of Manuel L. Quezon, the first Senate President, Manuel L. Quezon. You have Gil Puyat. You have, who was also former Senate President. You have Lorenzo Tañada. You have the Jokno, Senator Jokno, mga batikang na mga senador that really helped shape our country and who became future presidents. Many presidents came from the Senate. Not that we're saying we have presidential ambitions, but my point being is, medyo statesman-like kasi yung Senado. We have to always look above the fray. Now, kailangan ba natin ng Senado? Yes. Bakit? Ako'y naniniwala sa paggawa ng batas, it is not paramihan. It's not, mine is bigger than yours. There's an argument like that. It's not about that. It's not about paramihan. It's about the quality of legislation that we pass. Kung unicameral na po tayo, unicameral parliament, you think na pwede natin malagyan ng preno ang mga panukala na controversial? Let's say tax measures, additional tax measures, dagdagan yung buwis ng ating mga kababayan. Doon sa Senado, talagang pinag-uusapan namin ng matagal yan, anong impact sa taong bayan. We do our listening tours and all bago namin talakayan yan at debatian. So yeah, it's very, very important that we have that. There is a possibility na mawala ang Senado. And all these great men that I mentioned will be rolling in their graves, no? Pati si Senator Joker Arroyo, pati yung mga past sa atin, Senator Raul Rocco, Senator Edgardo Angara, all these great people will be rolling in their graves that under my watch, nawala yung Senado, Karen. I don't think...
So it looks like the way you sound, not on your watch.
Not on my watch. I mean, that's why there were coup threats against me. Well, it's fine. But I'm an institutionalist, Karen. I believe in the institution. Ako yung naniniwala sa institusyon ng Senado. Na kailangan talaga ito para may checks and balances. Hindi palaging, alam mo, galing na ako ng opposition. I was in the opposition during the time of President Arap. So, it was in the Senate that when we had our arguments against the administration at that time, we looked up at the Senate to help us in finding and ferreting out the truth because there was only 27 of us in the House of Representatives. Okay. So, hindi palaging nasa administration kayo. Baka may darating na panahon na nasa opposition din kayo. You will welcome that there is a Senate elected at large who believe in the who believe that the national interest is the most important interest for the Filipino people. With due respect to my friends in the House of Representatives, baka sabihin nila mayabang ako. Pero I've been there. Galing ako ng House of Representatives, Karen. 3 terms ako doon and I'm on my 3rd term as a senator. So, yes, the Senate is very important. At posibleng mawala ito pag nagkaroon ng CONCON. Palitan nila ng parliament. Eh kung parliament, di mawawala na yung... Alam mo, Karen, is another very important point. Pumayag ang CONCON na gawin ng parliamentary ang ating bansa, papayag kaya ang taong bayan na hindi nila ihahalal ang leader ng ating bansa?
Ang presidente.
Ang presidente. Or magiging figurehead na kasi ang presidente. Yung tatakbo ng bayan, ang prime minister. Papayag kaya ang taong bayan na sanay na po sila since the 1935 Constitution, we've been electing the president. One vote for every person counts. Tatanggalin natin yun, ibibigay natin yan sa unicameral body, Karen. Nako, magkakagulo yan. Hindi, siguro, they'll say, wow, exciting, exciting. But after how many elections that you see that very unpopular yung prime minister dahil hindi naman yan binoto ng taong bayan, tignan nyo, magkakagulo at magkakagulo din yan. Look at countries like Malaysia, Senate, they're having Rigodon every year, no, of their prime ministers and several other countries. Of course, Malaysia now is a new prime minister, but prior to that, they were having problems.
Yes.
And many other parliaments as well. So, napakahirap, Karen, na gawin ito. And also, Karen, really, my last point in the CONCON.
On the CONCON, go, last.
Yeah, they're planning to elect members to districts. Mm. Akin lang, Karen, maganda sana kung nilagay nila. Siguro pampaano na lang, pampagaan ng loob. Sana ginawa nila, linigyan nila ng anti-dynasty provision.
Uh-oh.
Yung tatakbo sa distrito, hindi yung kamag-anak, hindi yung asawa, hindi yung anak ng political kingpin. Diba? Up to the 4th degree of consanguinity.
Pwede.
Oh, up to the 4th degree of consanguinity. Tapos bawasan mo na yung sweldo, 10,000 pesos a day? 10,000 pesos a day ang sweldo nila. Gawin mo na lang 500 pesos a day. Well, gawin mo na lang 1,000 pesos a day. Bakit, Karen? Para mapabilis nila ang trabaho nila. Kasi kung 10,000 pesos a day, abot ng siyam-siyam yan. Baka 3 taon bago matapos yung CONCON na yan. And I really think that they should put an anti-dynasty provision so that the political kingpins will not have control. Because obviously, ang lalagay nila po sa distrito, let's be frank about it, will also be politically astute individuals na mananalo dyan or may political closeness sa politiko. So definitely, as the sun will shine tomorrow, Karen, ang papag-usapan din nila dyan, hindi lamang economic provisions, pati political provisions, pag-uusapan nila dyan.
Okay.
So I wasn't born yesterday. I have 20 years of legislation. I was part of the team of then Speaker Joe De Venecia on this issue on charter change. So I know what's being discussed, even if we're not invited. I know what's going on with my friends in the lower house. Ang akin lang dyan, let's go slow, hinahinay, let's discuss. Ako, why don't we lift our people out from poverty? Let's come up with single-digit numbers. Let us educate our people. Let's continuously educate our people. Para sa ganun, pagdating sa CONCON, pagdating sa plebisito, they can make an informed and right proper decision on their vote.
All right, hold your thought. All right. Now, before we go to a quick break, because you mentioned it already, but please make this quick, because we'll be discussing the bills that you've filed, the 150 peso wage hike. I want to ask you this. You said it yourself, because you stood up to your convictions when it comes to CONCON and charter change, that suddenly threats of a coup, a change in leadership in the Senate started to emerge, right? And Senator J.V. Ejercito said yesterday, that's baseless. He essentially said that you still have the support of your colleagues. Where is this coming from? Did you find out?
Your guess is as good as mine, Karen. Of course, Senator Erwin Gatchalian got information that it could be from my stand against charter change. And I also got it from another source dahil nairita daw yung mga pro-charter change sa akin dahil hindi daw ako sumasayaw ng cha-cha. Ang punto ko dyan, as I mentioned, Karen, I'm an institutionalist. I believe in the institution. I really believe in the sanctity and the wisdom of having a Senate, a bicameral system of government. And if it means my head, then so be it. I mean, so be it. But not on my watch, where I'm sitting here, Karen. And since 1916, where this has been the last bastion of democracy, that I allow it to happen, that I dissolve. I'm the person, the last Senate president who allowed the dissolution of the Senate. I don't think that's not going to happen on my watch, Karen. But my point there being is the timing is important. And let's address the real situation. Why people aren't investing in the Philippines?
Yes.
Binanggit ko na kanina sa iyo, Karen.
Yeah, you already know the services.
That's
yes,
very important.
You've made it really clear. It's been quite expansive and extensive. Now let's move on to how he sees a way to really address problems, to prioritize on actually addressing problems that the Philippines is facing. So recently he proposed a minimum wage hike of 150 pesos for all private workers. So Senate President Miguel Zubiri, how can you actually mandate, and is it actually wise to order private companies to do that? I mean, in the United States, you have Joe Biden ordering the biggest federal increase with salaries for government workers. But can you really legislate salaries for private workers, considering we have 90% of the businesses in the Philippines are MSMEs?
Well, Karen, you know, in the United States, looking at the United States model, they've increased in the last 10 years their minimum wage per hour. It used to be like $6 an hour. Now it's about $10 to $11 per hour, depending on the state. So napakalaki ng increase nila in the last decade. Ang atin, Karen, napakabagal, hindi gumagalaw. And we all know, because of the high cost of inflation, napakamahal ng bilihin. Ang masama dito, Karen, to be honest, many products, including agricultural products, nakatikim na yan ng mataas na prices, and therefore many of them are hesitant to bring these prices down, unless the president has a policy of importing everything, which of course will kill the agri-industry. So what do we need to do? Kailangan natin bigyan ang ating manggagawa ng tinatawag natin living wage. Hindi naman minimum wage, because the minimum wage is not a living wage. We also have to share. I think we have to share the blessings, Karen. Every time I watch The World Tonight, I watch it every 9 o'clock. And then if I miss it, I watch it at 12 midnight. I always look at the business side. I always look at the companies coming back from pandemic, pandemic levels, talagang they go back to the black. They're making a lot of money. There's an increase in income, particularly the oil companies and all the other companies that were doing poorly during the pandemic. Now, kaya ng akin lang, share naman natin. Share lang. Let's share to our people. I personally, you know, Karen, I'm not only a public servant, but I'm also a businessman. I do industrialize. We also have, I'm also a small power producer. I have renewable energy. We're doing hydro and all. All my employees that are minimum wage earners, they earn, I give them more than minimum wage. Okay. So whatever minimum wage is, I give them more. I give them more, right. A certain percentage more. I give them 15 months pay. So they get 13 months plus 2 years, 2 months bonus. So I'm an MSME, but my point is, tuwan-tuwa yung mga workers ko. I did it the same in the Senate. I was bashed in the Senate. I gave an inflation bonus, which is basically 130 pesos a day for the whole year. And I was bashed. Everybody was saying, sana all. Okay, sa ating mga kababayan na nagsasabing sana all, ito na to. Ito na. We'll try to pass a 150 peso legislated wage increase because we need to come up with an amount where our people are comfortable. Na talagang hindi po sila hirap na hirap at hindi po sila umiiyak na wala po sila pambayad sa gastusin na kanilang mga tahanan.
All right. And irony of this is, of course, in the lower house, it wasn't the majority who suggested an increase across the board. It was the Makabayan bloc, right? So that's the irony here is the majority in the Senate, well, coming from the Senate president himself, in effect, in a way, siding with the minority in the lower house. So I want to ask you, the ECOP says two things, so you can answer directly. They say if you raise the minimum wage further, only two things will happen. Small businesses will either cut the number of employees or they will raise the prices of their products. They claim that raising the minimum wage will only benefit 10% of the total number of workers in the Philippines to the detriment of the remaining 90%. So what do you think of that statement?
Well, why do you think there's a diaspora of Filipinos from the Philippines? Maalis sila. I saw a video online sa Facebook. I just happened to chance upon it. And in title nun, why Filipinos are leaving their own country. Number one, in-interview sila sa lahat ng mga bansa na pinupuntahan nila. Napakababa ng minimum wage. Napakababa ng sweldo ng ating bansa. That's the whole truth. That's why we have... How many million Filipinos? 12 million Filipinos abroad is because we don't pay the right or at least decent wages here in the Philippines. We have to address that, Karen. If we don't address that, we will have a brain drain. Mawawalan tayo ng workers. Tara, anong gusto nila? Pag-graduate ng college, gusto nila mag-abroad ka agad. Yung makakuha lang ng passport na hindi naman nakagraduate ng college, gusto mag-abroad ka agad. Bakit? Kung dito sila magtrabaho sa ating bansa, ang matatanggap nila ay, imagine, $10 a day, which is $10 an hour in the United States. Sa United States, status nyo is $10 an hour. Ang akin dyan, eventually, mawawalan din tayo ng manggagawa. I'm also asking the ECO, what is your solution? We're losing our workers. They're going abroad. They'd rather go abroad because nobody wants to share their blessings. Nobody. So, okay. I mean, your husband, DJ, works for Aboitiz. I know they can afford. They can afford this. Many other companies, the Aboitizes, the Lushotans, the Gokong Ways, all the major players can afford this. I'm sure they can afford this because I've seen their bottom line every time I watch the news.
Yeah, so that's ECOP's argument that only 10% can afford this. The MSMEs will be affected. But okay, let's move on because you make a good argument there. Is in effect with 500 plus 150, it evens out to something like 750. Tama po ba? That's your calculation, no?
Opo.
No, para magiging 750 a day ang minimum wage, which becomes a decent living wage. So my question now is political. This is where horse trading begins in some way, right? You may have the support of your colleagues with your bill, but then in the lower house, the majority isn't actually touching that yet. So what happens now for this to become law? You would need your colleagues in the lower house. And what if they ask, look, Senate President, we're asking you to at least even consider cha-cha before we even touch the increase in minimum wage. So paano to ngayon, Senate?
At kukulit na nga nila sa amin sa Maharlika pa lang eh. Hindi pa namin natatakal yung Maharlika. Yeah. So maybe we should tackle Maharlika first before we tackle about the cha-cha. Again, no, I'm going into the reasons why we're doing this. We want to help uplift our people's lives. You want to pass Maharlika? Okay, why? Because you want to invest in strategic industries? Okay, and be able to help make income, additional income for the country. But bottom line, it's to help our country move up, no, from the economic rut that we came in from the pandemic. And so that's the bottom line. We have to work together. The House of Representatives, Speaker Martin is a dear friend of mine. I, whenever we call each other brothers. Brother Martin.
But then he hasn't called you yet? The Speaker hasn't called you yet when it comes to...
No, because he knows my position already. I had this discussion with the President and Speaker Martin privately in the home of the President in Malacañang. And the President himself said, oo nga Martin, hindi ko priority ito. Then I'm busy going around selling the country and being able to fix the problems of the country. So right there and then I heard the President tell him that, you know, this magulo yan. And because of that, and he's a senator. He was a former congressman. He was a former senator. He's seen these charter change wars unfold. And it can be very divisive. It can be very divisive as an issue. So, nakita ko po yung stand ni Presidente doon. And I told the President, and I told Speaker Martin at that time, this can be very divisive. I don't have the numbers in the Senate. Can we just focus on the bills at hand, the LEDAC priorities, allow me to finish these LEDAC priorities, including Maharlika, so we can discuss it and debate on it on the floor. So they know my position on that. That's why, in fairness to my dear friend Martin, Speaker Martin, hindi niya siguro ako kinukulit na araw-araw. It's mostly the other congressmen. Pero ang punto ko dyan is, we're not ignoring them. Nandyan si Senator Padilla, he's going around doing his listening tour. He'll come up with his committee report. The thing there is, will he be able to get enough signatures to be able to tackle the committee report in plenary? So the process is ongoing in the Senate, and we're not ignoring our House of Representatives' counterparts. But at this point in time, allow me to pass the LEDAC-approved measures that will be able to help our people. So, when it comes to that, Karen, let's say pinasa namin yung legislative waste strike in the Senate at hingin ng horse trading or some sort of compromise, I leave it at that. I tell them, you know, this is good for the country. I leave it to the House of Representatives on how they feel about this issue. But what's important, at the end of the day, Karen, alam mo, lalo na sa mga probinsya, yung minimum wage nila doon 300 pesos, Karen, 300 pesos. What can you buy with 300 pesos? Inflation has not just reached Metro Manila. Inflation has reached Northern Mindanao. Inflation has reached Central Visayas. Inflation has reached everywhere. And I think we have to address that problem of inflation by also increasing. You know, I put 150 as the number. We can increase or decrease. We can make it 100 pesos. But the ECOP and all the business organizations should know that the people are suffering. They should ask they should talk to their workers. Talk to your workers and ask them, kaya nyo ba to na ganito yung presyo, yung sahod?
But there must be a science.
If they increase their salaries, they're going to have a more productive workforce.
But there must be, just quickly, there must be a science to the 750 number. Because even if you presented it differently from the Makabayan block, it all ends up with 750 a day.
There will be a price distortion, Karen. Mine is different from the Makabayan block. Because the Makabayan block wants 750 all across the board. Hindi naman pwedeng ganun sa mga areas na kung saan 300 pesos yung minimum wage, gagawin mo 750. Totoong sinabi ng ECOP, magkakagulo dyan. I mean, these businesses cannot pay double their wages of what they're paying now. No, they can't absorb that. Mine is 150 across the board. So basically, if it does 300 pesos in, let's say, in Samar or Northern Cebu, it will become 450. I think what they need is that additional cushion. So they can pay their bills, they can buy food for their children, they can, you know, nagtaas ang presyo ng bilin, tumaas din ang presyo ng basic utilities. So at least it's a cushion.
Okay, so Senate President, last question on that particular issue. Where are you now with this particular bill?
We just filed the measure. It will go to the committee of Senator Jingo Estrada. And historically, I've been filing this, Karen, for a while back now. I filed this in Congress. I filed this also in the Senate in my first term. And I'm also one of the proponents of yung na-veto ni President Duterte, which is the on job security. Security of Tenure Act. And you know, we passed that in the Senate, the Security of Tenure Act. And that was a very difficult thing to pass. It was vetoed by then President Duterte, unfortunately. So I really believe to have a strong economy, you have to have a strong and happy workforce, Karen.
All right. On that note, Senate President Juan Miguel Zubiri, I want to thank you for joining me today. This was an insightful, extensive interview. Thank you so much, sir. You have a good day.
I'm happy to be here, Karen. And God bless you and God bless your viewers. Mabuhay po ang ating bansa.